Okay, good afternoon. So now at this point in time, we are going to discuss the most awaited topic in website development, which is PHP. So at this moment, we have assumed that you have learned these three languages before it, which are very, very important. It means you have covered HTML, and also you have covered cascading style sheet, and you have covered JavaScript. These languages are very important for you to first understand before you look at PHP because that is an advanced language for website development. PHP basically is a server-side language, which means it runs on the server. It cannot just run on the client-side application. So then, what is PHP? What is PHP? Basically, PHP stands for Hypertext Preprocessor. So PHP is widely used open source script language, and it is always executed on the server, hence it is a server-side language. You can download PHP for free, and you can also use it to produce very powerful applications on the internet. It is powerful enough to be one of the biggest blogging system on the web applications, including WordPress and also Facebook. So it is also easy enough to be a beginner-based server-side language. So this means that there are so many server-side languages, but PHP is the best language that you can start with for you to understand what server-side languages can do. So then, what can PHP files, normally achieve? So a PHP file can contain text, can contain HTML, can contain cascading style sheet, it can contain JavaScript, it can contain PHP code itself. So you're not restricted with PHP where to write these codes. So PHP code is executed on the server and the result is returned to the browser as a plain text. So which means you cannot execute the PHP on the client side, application. You must always execute it on the server as Ada mentioned. So now let's look at what it can do. What PHP can do, it can also generate dynamic page content. It can also create open, read, write, delete, and close files on the server. It can also collect data from the phones. It can send, and receive cookies. It can add, delete, modify data in your database. And it can also be used to control user access. Where information is confidential. And also with PHP, you're not limited to output HTML. You can also output images, PDF files, even Flash movies. You can also output any text such as XHTML, extensible HTML, and also basically XHTML. So why PHP then? PHP runs on various platforms. It can run on Windows, it can run on Linux, Unix, Apple Mac, etc. So then, PHP is compatible with most of all servers used today, talking about Apache and ICE, etc. So PHP supports a wide range of databases, and it is free. You can download it and able to use it to develop applications, most special websites which are dynamic. So now, coming to the most important part now, the programmer or developer. What is the PHP syntax? PHP script can be placed anywhere in the code document. Right? So PHP script start with the tag, where you put a question mark, PHP itself. You end with a question mark, then you can also close the tag. So everything that you write with regards to PHP is supposed to be written in the PHP tag. This tag is very, very important for you to write PHP very well. So the default file extension for the PHP is always .php. Just like if you write in HTML files only, you can also write, you save them as .html. So for PHP files, you always save them as .php. So PHP file normally contains HTML tags and some other PHP scripting code. It won't conflict with that. That's a bit about PHP. You can embed HTML in it, and it will still work. Or you can embed PHP code in HTML, it will still work. So now below, we are going to look at an example of PHP file, which is going to echo an output, hello world. So look at this, okay, code. This code basically, from here, okay, we can see that mostly it is HTML. As I mentioned that you can embed PHP in HTML, as long as you run it in the server, as opposed to just a client or simply a browser. So what you are seeing here, okay, want to echo a hello world. So this code is going to output a hello world, right? Once you run it on the server, and it's going to do just like that. So for the server to output a hello world, it is going to demand that you include the PHP tag, which is this one. So once you include this and you execute this in the server, you will discover that this hello world got put together with HTML content, as you can see there. So one thing that we need to understand is the client-side languages can run on the server side. They are not the opposite. So server-side languages can't run client-side applications. So that's why even if you run this program, it is going to execute the HTML code together with the PHP code, because HTML is client, so it can run on the server together with the PHP, which is purely server language. So PHP is case sensitive, so you must be very careful with the words that you use. Okay, so you must look at the cases, upper cases and lower cases. They mean something different, so you must be very careful with the use of those things. For example, here, right? Here is an example of three echo statements. We've got this echo capital letter, echo small letter, so on so forth. So you can see that with the capital letter echoes, it will not basically do what you need, but with the small letter echo, it will do the business, because with echo, we write it with a small letter arrangement. So now, however, all variables names are case sensitive also. So if you declare a variable with a small letter, you must maintain small letters. Look at an example below. Only the first statement will display the value of the color variable. This is because color, small letter, and color capital letter, and this color combination of capital and small, are treated as three different variables. So if you assign red to this variable, you find that it will echo red in this way, but it won't echo red here because this is capital and this is a different arrangement. So you must be very, very mindful of the cases that are used, most especially when it comes to variables. So speaking of the PHP variables, we can look at how you can declare them. So a variable have a short name, for example, it can be X or Y, or a more descriptive name such as age, name, total, so on and so forth. Now, there are rules that need to remember as you actually deal with these arrangements you're talking about. So number one, a variable starts with a dollar sign followed by the name of the variable. If you omit a dollar sign, it will not work. A variable name must start with a letter or underscore character. A variable name cannot start with a number, it's not possible. A variable name can only contain alphanumeric characters and underscores only. The variable names are case sensitive, so you must be very careful as well a little bit. Remember that PHP variables are case sensitive. That must be underlined, it's very, very important. So output variables we have in PHP, one of them we've looked at already, echo. Echo can be used to display the results of processing. right? So the following will produce the same output as the example above. So we have this, okay, example here, and want to echo I love dot this, okay, text want to produce there. So the following will output the sum of two numbers, this one here. So there's remember we said you start with the dollar sign, this is the variable x, so assign it 5. Variable y, because there's a dollar sign, we assign it 4. But when you echo x plus y, it will give you 9, because that is what it's going to do. So PHP is loosely typed language. So in the example below, notice that, okay, we did not have to tell PHP which data type the variable is. So we cannot actually be saying this is int, or this is text, or this is string, or what? It is loosely typed language, right? It will do according to the word interprets the information coming. So PHP automatically associates a data type to the variable, depending on its value. Since the data type are not sent in a strict sense, you can do things like adding a string to an integer without causing an error, right? Of course, that in PHP 7 type declaration were added. So this includes an option to specify the data types expected when declaring a function. By enabling the strict requirement, it will throw a fatal error on the type mismatch. Right. So in PHP, we have foreign conditions that can also be applied in JavaScript, as they are. Okay, alluded to. So we've got selection statements, which includes the if, the double selection, the if else, and the multiple selection, the switch statements. They're very helpful because they help us to make a decision, to apply some interactivity, some intelligence, okay, as you focus on connectivity with PHP. For example, you can use the single selection, you can say if, put a condition, then you can execute the action that is going to work according to that. So for example, as an example, we've got the variable t, which is going to do a function of a date. So say if time is less than 20, you can echo have a good date because it is less than 20. Right. So this is, okay, a very powerful aspect of PHP if apply the selection statements as well as the reputation statements, which are the for loop, the while, and so on and so forth. So we've got, apart from that, we've got the inbuilt functions, which are written in PHP. But you can also define your own functions. As you can see, PHP user-defined functions, the ones that you can use to achieve the particular task you want, according to your own liking. So a function basically is a block of statements that can be used repetitively in the program. So a function will not execute automatically when the page loads. Instead, the function will be executed by a call or an invocation of the function. So create a user-defined function in PHP. The syntax is basically as follows. You write, just like in JavaScript, you write a function, then the function name, then you put the execution of the code. As long as if that code is going to be executed on the server, you must remember to include it in the PHP tag. Otherwise, it will not work. Right. So, for example, you've got this function which is going to be executed in PHP. So, you write the function inside, then it will actually be invocated, your code here, so it can do the hello world here. So, basically, it is very easy to do the functions if you have mastered the functions in JavaScript already. That's why before you do PHP, it is highly recommended that you understand HTML, you understand cascading style sheet, and you also understand JavaScript. Then it becomes very easy for you to look at all these things that you're discussing here today. So now these are the examples. Like for example, there's the function called add numbers with arguments or parameters such as int. Remember to put the dollar sign for the variable. And then this is going to return the addition of a plus b. So when echoing this, if I want to call this one, just prohibit parameters like that, then it will do the business. So basically, it's very easy to deal with functions, provided that you understand the JavaScript functions, all that you looked at earlier. So PHP returns okay, type declaration in 7, where this is going to be, because the base here is really to specify the expected type of the function, otherwise it will be here. So types such as the float, okay, the int, can be incorporated in PHP 7, as it is the latest version. So here's an example here, of course, this example function which adds, okay, in this case now we say float, because we don't want just to just say $A, $B. Now we are going to specify clearly what we want, and you specify the kind of answer we want. In this case, we want an integer, so it will turn the type as well. Okay, so for example, you can use the pass by reference argument to update, okay, a variable for this one here, PHP. You can say function add fine. And they can also say we want to pass a value. Right, these are pointers, you all pass a reference, and then you say a value plus, okay, values plus 5 is supposed to get, okay, the reputation of that value when you add it together and you give it the answer according to the program they want to tell the program to do. So basically, these are the principles, okay, that you need to understand for you to master PHP very well. So at this moment, I would like to show you. Since I've looked at how to create a database in SQL using the WAMP server, we have looked at how to create HTML pages which are static, and we have looked at how to look at the loops and the presentations of the page, and the interactivity of the page by incorporating the JavaScript that validates the inputs on the forms. So this time, I want to show you how to connect. Pass the data form values to the database, and also able to retrieve the data from the database and show it on the page, on the web page, using PHP. So now, to begin with, I want you to look at this program that I've just typed. This program, okay, is about a page that is going to have a form, a user form, that will register some users. But because I want to make it very simple, I will just register two details or attributes of this user. Now, this is going to post this information to the database, okay, which was created using my SQL, as earlier illustrated last class I showed you. And then from there, we're going to create two PHP files that are going to pass this information to the database, and later on get the information from the database and put it on the page. So this is a very interesting part of website development. Wherever you go, okay, most companies are looking for people who can do what I'm going to show you now. So as you can see, the first thing to do, we make the interface, okay, which is this one, the page. So this page, okay, is going to take an action, which is going to connect, okay, a PHP file connected, which I'll show you. And it's going to use the method post to post the information to the database, as you can see. So this is the table, okay. We have used the form to organize the data very well in table. I'm going to have student, okay, recorded. I'm going to have the name of the student, and the information will be recorded as follows. The left, I'm going to submit this information to the database and be posted using this PHP. So what are we talking about, people? So we are talking about, okay, this form as the landing page we are going to interact with first. Let me just quickly run this page so that you can see how it is looking like. Quickly, I want to go to this page so you can see. By the way, this work should be saved on the server for you to see it well. So this is the page I'm talking about. Okay, this is our landing page. So the code that you are seeing is producing a page that looks like this, where someone can enter the details here and submit the information to the database. Now, let me show you the code that will take the data from this form get it to the database, right? So we have, okay, we get back to the web. So there is this one, okay, called connect. Remember, we have put the action connect one with PHP. So let me show you, it's a file that is going to be taking the data from this form to the database which is created. So here's the way. Now this file is going to indicate the registration form complete. That is, if you click on submit. So now the PHP, so you have to define, okay, the prerequisite of the PHP is the server. So I have to put the host, okay, server, which is the local server, which we know, okay, it is 126.0.0.1. That is our IP address for the local server. If you're using the one, then the user, if you're using the one for the first time, it's always the root. Unless if you define, put your own settings, you can put the username there. And the PS is basically the password. Again, if you're using the one for the first time, you have not defined the settings, it is always blank. That's why it is kept blank here. But if you have defined it, you have set it up, you can put your own password there for security reasons. Then what you are seeing here, the student ID, we are defining a variable that we're going to use to do the posting of the data from the student ID to the database. So this side is how I'm going to define the database, okay, attributes, which is going to be given to this, okay, variable, which I'm going to use in the program to do the reasoning and the computation for me to post the data. So as you can see, I only have the student ID and the student name. So this is what you have in this form. Okay, the name and the ID. So make sure that when you put the input type, you specify the name, okay? So this name is the student ID, and this name is student name. So that's why we are using them here, because that's what we have as the names of the data in the forms. Then what is this part here? All right, so these are just the variables that you are, okay, setting. Then what is here? Now here I'm establishing a connection. Okay. Connection. Established. Okay. So as you can see, this is my SQL statement or method that will connect this database to the server, as you can see. So what you are seeing here, these are the server, okay, the host server, and the username and the password, which will be connected, which will enable the database to be connected to the PHP, okay, to the PHP code. So now I need to test, okay, to test this connection. If it is false, then it's going to say not connected to the server. Otherwise, if this connection is successful, that's where the business is. Now, we have to write the MySQL method that will select the database that you're going to work with. Remember last time we created our database that you're calling MyData, which is, okay, only containing two attributes, which is the student ID and the student name. So if the connection to the server is true, then you have to select the database, connect to the database that you're going to use. So if this is going to be successful also, then the database connection will echo the success, okay, flag. Now once the database is connected, then you can now write the SQL statement that will set values, okay, from the form, okay, into the database you have. So you write the insert into value from the table, okay? Then since we are going to have only two attributes, the student ID and the student name, then the values will be coming from the forms, which have specified student ID and also student name. So these are the details that will be entering into these attributes of the database once you connect to the database. So now I have to check it. If this query is successful, is executed well, and with the connection of the server, then you can say this operation is successful. You can echo that. Then you can now look at how, you can now look at which rows will be affected once this is done. Because once you enter the values, you affect the rows. The rows, the one that we call the tuples, right? So you affect them, so you have to put this method to say my SQL affected rows method that is going to update or refresh the values that enters into the database. Otherwise, if this is not true, the values have not entered and then you have not affected the rows, it's supposed to indicate connection failed. So basically, this part here executes the insert into values when the database has been connected, and then if it is successful, then you move on to another aspect, which is very, very important, that after you finish everything that you are doing with the database, it is wise to close the connection and close the database. Right, so if the connection is successful, the closing is successful, then you're going to echo, connection closed. Right, so this code basically is going to take data, from the forms, HTML forms, into the database. How is it going to work? Let's demonstrate. So we are here already. Okay? So once you enter data the ID is 95. You also enter name there, numbers. Then once you click on submit, you need to have this, coming. Database connection successful, the connection is successful, and it has closed what? It has closed the connection. So this is what we're talking about. This is what the PHP will do, and it will report back that it has finished its business. Right. So the code we are talking about, right? The code you're talking about here, that's what it will do. Once you click on the submit button, it's supposed to take those values into the database from the forms. These are the form, details that will, be inputted into the database actual attributes, as you can see from here in this table that we created using my SQL. Right. So now there's a need for you to see what you have entered into the database. So that's why there's another PHP file which we're calling retrieve. So now this PHP file is going to be retrieving data to give you a list of registered names that you have put there. So you do the prerequisite all the time since you're connecting to the server. This we have discussed already up to this point. Now, when the connection is true, is false, it will ensure that you have not connected to the server. Otherwise, if the connection is done, what is next to do? Connect the database that you have created in the server. Once it is connected now, then attempt to select query execution so that you can select the details from the table so that you can put on the actual form. So as you can see, the retrieve record query, you do the select. Last time I showed you the select, how it works. It picks the data from the table and output them in the table form. So you say select, the student, want to select the student name from this table. Then the result, I want to query this, I'm going to take this retrieval and the connection to the database together so that it can fetch those details from the database, which is connected to the server. So once you do that, you need to create a variable that will get all the results of this select statement. So that if you get that result from this row, then you can now do this select statement. So if the MySQL num row gets the values from this this connection, it's above zero. It means you have entered something. If it is above zero now, we have to create a table in PHP that is going going to have the student ID and the student name. Then I'm going to do a repetition statement, which is going to run through all the details that are in the table so that you can put them. So I'm supposed to say if this role, okay, when you fetch all the details from the argument, which is the select statement, then put them on the table, okay, where it says student ID, put all the student IDs, and where it says student name, put all the student names. Then this is going to output the details from the database table into the HTML tables which you have put it. Then you need to free the results. Okay, you can free the results. The last statement should end to free it, so it stops executing, so that you avoid getting into a continuous loop. Then from there, if all these what is above is not true, supposed to say no records matching your query form, then to give you this error message. Then to close the connection, as all the time, it's very important to close the connection. And then we have put this button to finish, you can go back to the new page. So let's see how this is called. Okay. So if you look at this part, which I didn't talk about under connections, once you submit the data to the database, you need to put this code, okay, which is going to call the retrieve PHP and post information and submit. So let's see how this is going to work. So now imagine that we're here now, we have submitted the data to the database. Now we need to retrieve what you've entered into the database. When you click on retrieve, you won't have these details. So the data from the database has been obtained, and this is what you have. Remember, we entered 95 markers, and before that, I had to enter some couple of details in the database, so that as I output, the details can actually be done. Okay, there are just some number of details in the table. Okay, so now this is how you work out, okay, a website which is going to require that you get a dynamic form where people can submit their request to the form, and you get those details from the forms to the database, and later on you can view those details on the web page, as you can see from here. So basically, this is what is very, very important for a website developer if you want to be successful in this regard. So people, this is how far you can go. And I'll urge you to watch this video several times for you to master it and be able to understand it better. If you have more information regarding how to do this, please subscribe to the channel so you can have details, or you can contact me for more information besides this. Thanks, guys.